in front of looking at something. It's kind of weird. Okay. Your keys, Brother Travis, don't let me keep them. You like me one day looking for your keys for 30 minutes. After church. All right. Okay, we are talking in the book of Galatians today, the 3rd chapter, verse 1. And we're going to say, bewitched. Bewitched. Anybody got a quick definition for that word, bewitched? It's only shown up one time in the Bible. That's what we find in the book of Galatians, bewitched. And maybe someone will give me a commentary on the word foolish. I'm sure you'd use that in your modern day language, foolish.
Wasn't there some, program on TV once called Bewitched?
Oh, yeah.
Trickery.
Bewitched. That's right. Yeah. Bewitched. That's right. Anybody got a definition on bewitched? How would you say it?
Under the influence of
demonic
spirits.
Satanic.
Yeah. So. Okay.
It's in my memory.
That'll work. Under the influence. I wonder, do you... Now, this is going to be pertaining to doctrine and not behavior. I'm going to say theology. This is under the theology, belief system that you opt in, opt out. And Paul called it bewitched.
You can use, let's say, false, unreal.
How about this unbelievable?
yeah.
Unbelievable. There's no comprehension in this.
Yes.
So.
Foolish, unwise.
See? Okay. So that's what Paul called the people at the Galatia church. First he said foolish. Now foolish is something that we use all the time. Much modern day. Here, foolishness is that just unwilling to understand, unwilling to come to the correct understanding. Foolish. I mean, you must know better, but you choose to do it the other way. You choose to do it the foolish way. I mean,
you divert it.
I come to church in a t-shirt today would be like foolish. a short cutoff. That would be like foolish. I mean, you knew that.
Especially a better, in this kind of weather.
Yeah, no, that's a better way to go than that way. So that's foolish. Now, here Paul says, unwilling to understand. Unwilling to understand. And it's not because the proper way has not been told. A better way has not been shown or the correct way. The right way has not been shown. In this case, it's not because the gospel has not been preached to you, but you're doing foolish stuff, and it's not because you don't know or have not heard of the gospel. Some people do stupid stuff because they have not heard the true gospel. But once you have delivered the true gospel to people, and they've been under that teaching and so forth, and then they turn around and do foolish stuff. Why are you doing it the foolish way? And bewitched is that I just cannot believe that you cannot come to an understanding that this is not reality. So let's see here about bewitched and foolish. Foolish, unwilling to understand. All right. Now, I know all of us in here do, but I'm sure there have times that we have run into people who have no confidence in the convincing and converting power of the Holy Ghost. Have you ever run across someone who is not persuaded in the convincing and converting power of the Holy Ghost? think about the job of the Holy Ghost is to, one of them is to convict us of sin and instruct in righteousness. So have you ever run across anybody that has heard preaching, teaching that's contrary to, that seems as though you have no confidence, they have no confidence in the convincing and converting power of the Holy Ghost? One thing is about it, his work is invisible. I mean, his hands-on work is invisible. But his results are quite tangible. But I can't see the Holy Ghost working on Candy's weakness until it is manifested that she has gotten the victory. But when I see her squabbling in her defeat, I can see that the Holy Ghost hasn't convinced or converted from that particular, say, bondage or defeat. But when I see the outcome, she doesn't smoke, she doesn't curse anymore. Then I'm convinced that the Holy Ghost did that. But from the interval, from A to Z, I don't see the work, the hands-on work of the Holy Ghost. So therefore, I could be not persuaded that the Holy Ghost is working on the person. Brother Travis came in here with a pack of cools in that pocket where that handkerchief is. He ain't leaning on the Holy Ghost. But could the Holy Ghost still be working on him?
Yeah.
And could I say, Brother Travis, you can't do no altar call with them cools up there in your we don't see no victory, so you got to sit out. You got to go somewhere else. Going over across the street to Timmons. So, the work of grace is a work that is so invisible to us a lot of the times, and we don't see the convincing and converting power of the Holy Ghost. So therefore, we have to throw in something different or something else to get this thing going, which is called merit. Merit. I haven't gotten to scriptures yet.
Did you just say merit?
Merit, M-E-R-I-T, merit. And sometimes we prescribe merit behavior to what we think is going to aid the Holy Ghost in convincing and converting the person. And he needs no help. Oh, but it's a job to get an institution, an organization, an individual to trust in the power of faith in what the Holy Ghost will do. And the Holy Ghost won't work because there is no word. That's the only reason why it won't work. There's no word. No hope, no word. And I'm going to show you when I'm in my word, the gospel preached. We'll see here in a little bit that the gospel was preached long before the four books of the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Mm-hmm. The gospel was preached long before that. Mm-hmm. Ooh, so let's just see. All right. Here's what Paul says. Verse 3 and verse 2. Can someone read, please?
This only what I learn of you.
Verse 3 and 1.
O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you? This only what I learn of you, receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith?
Okay, O foolish, in other words, O unwilling to understand, Galatians, who has bewitched or who has deceived you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ evidently set forth, crucified among you? Now, the only way, that he says, I only have one argument, one thing to present to you. This I want to know of you. How did you receive the things of God that you have experienced? By the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? That's his only argument. He says, here's my test. How did you receive the things of God? Baptism of the Holy Ghost, saved by grace, healing, gifts of the Spirit that you may be in possession of. How did you receive that? By hearing of faith or by working out something in the law? That's easy for us to answer today on this side of the cross. How did you get healed? How did Sister Denise get healed? Was it by her working out something in the law? Or was it by her applying faith from the gospel that she knew? How did you get your financial miracle? How did you get your whatever success, whatever achievement, overcoming victory you have in life that you got over that? How did you do it? And a lot of people would straight up would tell you, oh, the Lord was just good, was good to me. There are some people who will tell you that they actually did something for God to have done this manifestation in their life, even today. And some people that are doing meritorious stuff to obtain blessings, favor of the Lord. Some people move to the country. I know a bunch like that. It's better out here with the Lord in the country. Okay. I'll mess with them, I just look at them and smile. And then there's some people who want to wear long dresses. No earrings, no makeup, no high heels. Don't go swimming, don't go skating, don't go bike riding, don't play sports. Don't do any of these things because it messes up your achievement as far as the favor of God. And Paul wants to know, the things that you get from God, that you have experienced, did it come from working out that thing, or did it just come because the Spirit manifested itself? And you had faith in what the Spirit would do. You just open up to faith. Just in to believe. So, we'll see if we can get you guys stirred up here in just a minute. He says again in verse 3, he calls them what? Foolish. Foolish. You're so foolish. And foolish is that you're not willing to come to an understanding. You're not open to coming to an understanding. You're so foolish. So foolish. We know the question is, how did you get the things that you got from God? You experienced them through a spiritual reality. So he says that since it came through a spiritual of faith, how are you made perfect by the flesh? We hear a lot on the word flesh, and so flesh here is not like we are thinking. Pinching yourself and it hurts. Sorry, what? That's not what he's talking about. He's not talking about your body. He is talking about you are made perfect by working through the law. Working through the law. Working something out. Some type of a merit system. Some type of achievement system. You think you're made perfect by obeying some type of systematic approach to achieving things of God. And he says, how about you think you're getting perfect that way? So he says that you are made perfect by the flesh, he's talking about you. You think you're made perfect by a systematic approach through some type of system that gets you close to God.
By doing something.
Huh?
By doing something.
By doing something. He says, no, you're not made perfect that way. So, what have we here? How did you receive the Spirit? How did you get saved? And if you think your salvation has come by working out something through a systematic way, he says Christ died in vain.
That's right. If the law had been perfect, there would not have been a need for Christ. If it had been perfect,
And the only reason why Paul could say that is because he knew that at one time this bunch was sold out to salvation through Jesus Christ. So if you say Christ is the Savior, He is your Savior, then you can't say also that I'm made perfect by some type of systematic work through, or workout, workbook, or anything. You can't say that you come out perfect. He says you can't do it that way. You can't have a working system and a substitute, because that's what we're going to find out that Christ was for us, as our substitute. Now, okay, here we go, verse 4. That's why he says, have you suffered so many things in vain, if it yet be in vain? Have you suffered so many things in vain? Now, okay. Let's, someone read verse 5, if you will, please.
He therefore that ministers to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith?
Okay. He that's going to work miracles, he that has worked miracles. He therefore that ministered to you the Spirit. Who is the he? To the preacher? The he in this letter, in this sentence. Is that he a minister, a preacher? A personality, a person?
Then it could be the Holy Ghost too.
It could be, I say he therefore that minister you the Spirit is the Holy Ghost himself. Now he could be working through an individual, but that could be in a she. So it could have been those, but here is he. He is the Holy Ghost. He that ministering to you the Spirit. You got the Spirit from the Spirit, the Holy Ghost. And working miracles, he that's working miracles among you, that's nobody more than the Holy Ghost. An individual cannot come up with miracles just in his own will. You know, I'm going over to John's house, I'm giving him a work of miracle. I'm ordained, anointed. I'm going over there to give John a miracle. So it's not a human being. It's the Holy Ghost and His will doing whenever and whatever He pleases. That's He. He is the personality of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit. Here He comes. The Spirit, therefore, the Spirit that worketh, that ministereth to you, the Spirit. And work miracles among you, do it. See, then it gets the little e. Is that person, is he doing it by the works of the law? I mean, when I say little h, it's a little h. Do it he, that there is a little h. Do it he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Is that minister bringing you or working miracles among you by the hearing of faith, or is he doing it by the works of the law? How many have seen a miracle come out by the works of the law?
Yeah.
Sister Sylvia got out of her high heels so she could get her knees healed. That was a miracle. Oh, a miracle. It was the high heels all the time. It was the high heels all the time.
Oh. Now the Holy Ghost might have told him to get out of his high heels. Because he teaches all things.
Yeah, but Sister Deborah did the first stroke.
Maybe she did. And that's what he's been telling you.
Finally called him. Oh, boy. She didn't want him to go fishing. Okay, so here we go. How do I get my miracle? Stop smoking them cigarettes. At least you get your lungs.
Let's go back to the example.
Get the kneecaps here.
Sylvia,
yeah.
About her flat shoe. What are you wearing today?
Flat.
Okay, all right. And she bowed her head and said, yes, she did get out of that. That, to me, is a physical component. There are some things, there is a natural and there is a spiritual.
Uh-huh.
Her doing that was a physical component. Now, did that alone do it? No, not necessarily. And I think they have to work together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ah.
Work together. And it doesn't mean that by her going from heels to flat, that's going to necessarily accomplish it. But that's a part of it. That's the physical side. That's the way I see it.
Well, the Holy Ghost teaches all things. The Holy Ghost might have said, hey.
Yes, that's
Sister
right.
Sylvia, you've got this problem. And
heels make your kneecaps efficient.
It does take you out of alignment.
Yes, it does. There's medical evidence that indicates, because when I get home, the first thing that goes are these high heel shoes. I only wear them on Sunday. But there's medical evidence that will show that. Mm-hmm. And this is just her personal testimony, Joyce Meyer. And if you notice now, she ministers in lower heels. And she used to wear high ones, and she says some old lady told her, when you get old, you're going to have some problems with this. And she looked at her and said, hey, you old, what can you tell me? She didn't say that to her. She thought, you know, what can you tell me? And then what she was saying was, you know, that lady was right. I'm down in my back now. So, you know, but
we'll
I guess it depends
can,
on... Yeah, okay,
we'll
let's disciple it.
Okay. Deal with this, okay? We'll get more scripture so we can...
All right, let's deal with it.
Cover this up. Heel stuff.
Yeah, see, you men are wearing high heel shoes. And I tell Pastor on Sunday.
Yeah, we used to.
You have us standing up. Not like those 3-inch heels.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but they had a platform on them. They didn't have.
Yeah, they had.
I forgot about that, bro. Okay. All right. So, verse 5 again. That H-E, I believe, is the Holy Ghost, not a person, not an individual minister, but the Holy Ghost. He, therefore, that ministers to you the Spirit, the Holy Ghost giving you his Spirit and pointing it into you, and working miracles among you, doeth, we got the little H here, this is an individual, a man, a person, doeth he it by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Do you get your miracle? Do you get the Holy Ghost working for you by M-E-R-I-T, or by your heart hearing
and believing
and getting full of faith? See, Brother Travis and the Holy Ghost was, he had a packet of cigarettes in his pocket there, and the Holy Ghost was working on me and saying, call Travis up and we're going to work a miracle through him. And Travis is, he come up here smelling like the tobacco factory. Smoke coming out of his ears as he's on his way up. And then I lay hands on him in the name of Jesus and clear that demon off of him, that addicted tobacco demon, whatever that demon is called. In the name of Jesus, I preached to him. He heard the sermon. He got faith to get loose from that cigarette addiction. Did he do it by throwing the cigarettes away, or did he get his miracle by hearing faith?
Hearing faith.
Yes, by hearing faith.
Got by hearing faith. Some person came in here all afflicted, disease bound, beat up, everything, negative talking, everything. They're sitting out in the audience. Do they get their miracle by the hearing of faith, or by taking the Tylenol and the pill and that one and this one and that one and the cold pack and the hot pack? Or do they get their miracle by the hearing of faith?
Hearing of faith.
That's what Paul wanted to know. How did you get your miracle? That's what he's asking them. How did you get the things that you got from God? How did you get it? By the hearing of faith, or by doing something? He don't smoke cigarettes no more because he got what? Liver. and he heard faith.
Yes.
And tomorrow he'll hear faith again. And he'll also hear that demon, cigarette demon, Mr. Cool Pack, talking on his door. But the hearing of faith will be louder than the hearing of the cigarette pack.
Mm-hmm. What if he kept them in his pocket?
He'll probably go home and throw them away. Because the hearing of faith, what he hears the most, the louder amplification, is what his heart's going to respond to. Because he's going to go home, he's got a carton in his drawer. Or maybe in the car ashtray. Yeah? People get delivered at that altar, they're going to turn right back around and go back to their environment that's full of what they got delivered from. But if the hearing of the gospel is louder than the hearing of what the devil's got to throw to them, or more frequently than what the devil has thrown to them, they're going to hopefully respond to what? Whatever they respond to in their hearing is what they're going to get their deliverance from.
So if they go home and let that carton stay in the drawer, they are allowing the hearing of the cool to be louder than the hearing of faith. They are allowing that.
The hearing of the gospel is the teaching of separation and all that. So you got to hear that to louder than you got hang with the boys.
Yeah. At some point in time, that temptation's got to be physically removed.
Yes, right.
It's got to be, right. Because if you just keep it there, yeah. Brother Travis, every Sunday he comes to church, he's got it up in his pocket. Mm-hmm. Just keep it there and see it saying, I'm here in faith, I got deliverance. Mm-hmm. That's going to always be a source of temptation for him.
Sure.
But if he removes that thing, then it's less of a temptation.
Sure.
You don't have it in your drawer at home and say, well, I'll throw this one away and I can go, because I got a stash at home.
Yeah. That's my true repentance is always the denunciation of
It's got to be
whatever it is.
So the foolishness would have been to keep it in his pocket.
He'd been like
the
foolishness.
That is absolute foolishness.
The foolishness would have been keeping it in his pocket.
Yeah. People thinking that, well, I'm delivered now. I can go back around this or I can do this.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I say, okay, well, God said, hey, I never went up to an altar, but I'll stop smoking on my own.
Some people got natural willpower. Just real strong willpower.
Yeah. I never had a group pray for me to stop drinking, but I stopped drinking.
Some people can do that.
You said that really delivered. Okay, we're itemizing sin, but to say that, let's put it like this. I stopped sinning, but I never went to church. Oh, I never heard a preacher.
You
gotta hear the word. That's right. A lot of you guys out there, I'm talking to the camera about church. I stopped sinning, but I never went to church. I never confessed Jesus as my Lord and Savior, but I stopped sinning.
When you think that they're in their life, somebody is praying for them, you know, and also the word to get to them, somebody is praying for them.
They're hearing something of the gospel somewhere.
Somebody is praying. I mean, I know when I quit smoking, I mean, I wasn't in church, but I knew. But my wife was praying for me. Yeah.
Would you call that grace working for you?
Yeah. Okay. I knew that God had prophesied that I would be saved, So I knew all those things. But when it happened, it wasn't nothing.
How many people came out of you, really? You got to stop this and that. You got to start this and that. You got to stop and do this and that. That's what would have been work. And did it do anything for you? Merit stuff?
Because I had good teachers and good parents as a sinner. There was a lot of things I didn't do, and I exerted my will not to do it, but that did not mean that I was still not a sinner. I was still all the righteousness was sin.
To bring you to Christ, what did you eventually be convicted of? Convinced and converted of?
Right.
The gospel. There was nothing your mom taught you.
There was nothing she taught. That's right.
It was a story, it's a reality, what Jesus did for you. Really,
well, that's what people get tripped up though, because they think because they did something natural based on what somebody else taught them or something like that they're okay. Mm-hmm. But all unrighteousness is sin.
Mm-hmm. That's part of the lesson too. So all of it is sin. So it's not that I put the cigarettes down or I stopped this and started that and this and that. It's the hearing of faith that brought you across the line. Mm-hmm.
Right. Because if one had the ability to do it, to receive salvation, when we were talking about mm-hmm. on his own, there would have been no need for Christ to come
that's
to
right.
die.
That's
if we
right.
could
that's
do
right.
it independent. Right. But yet, on the other hand, there are some things that people can just naturally stop doing. It doesn't mean that they're saved.
That's right. That's right. That's right. Stop. People start to stop new habits all the time.
Yeah.
Hobbies
yeah.
all the time.
Right.
Every day.
Like exercising.
Yeah. Stop doing something. Oh, now I'm delivered from being a couch potato. I get up and.
Yeah.
Really?
Now that didn't save you.
That didn't save you.
Exactly.
Now I'm in good health. Really?
Yeah. Oh. When I gave my life to Christ, became born again. When I came here, when mm-hmm. I came with a lot of baggage,
mm-hmm.
A lot of addictions,
mm-hmm.
and my strongest addiction was
yeah.
marijuana.
Smoking,
yeah. God delivered me. You know, of course, I thank him and I promised him.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I confess one thing. I said, marijuana has been a crutch for me.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be that easy.
Mm-hmm.
To give it up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everything else, I gave up that day.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, but this
mm-hmm.
is going on later.
Mm-hmm.
But I know it's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was in, you know, Easter Sunday 2002.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
By September came, you know, I was able to put it down. Because
uh-huh.
I knew I would. You know,
yeah.
Of course, you know, coming to church,
kept
hearing the gospel,
mm-hmm.
reaffirming
uh-huh.
that. You know, come September of that year,
uh-huh.
I put it down
uh-huh.
and it stayed.
Yeah.
So it stayed there.
Yeah. Yeah. That's
so even though I got the victory,
uh-huh.
I had to apply it, you know.
Sure. You had to apply what you hear.
What I heard. Huh?
Applied faith.
That's right.
Yeah. Applied faith. Yeah. Okay. That's good. That's very good. Okay. Now, here we go. Here we go again. Had something else. All right, now. Question to the class, was faith in the Old Testament, or was it the law that got people close to God? That got the miracles happening? You name your story in the Old Testament. Was it faith, or was it the hearing or hearing to the law that got God to move for the patriarchs in those stories? Or was it faith or the hearing of the law?
It had to be faith.
It was one story comes to mind as Joshua and Caleb.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That had to be faith for them to say we can.
Now, what these Jews was hung up on was the fact that you need to adhere to what Moses said and do it the way Moses said it. But Paul comes out and say faith was before Moses.
Yeah, it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the avenue to God has always been faith. Applied faith. It's always been the avenue to have a relationship with God. It's never been nothing else. Whoa, really? Yeah, the only faith. Verse 6, even as Abraham did what?
Believed.
Even as Abraham believed God, it was accounted to him for what? Righteousness. So the only way you're going to be right with God is that you are in believing. The only way that you are in believing. Anything else is adding to the recipe, and as Paul said last week, that is.
Let him be a curse.
Let him be a curse. Put some more stuff in this component, this recipe. You're mixing it up. You come up with another gospel. The only thing that makes this gospel mix what it is today, or what it is ever has been, is faith in the invisible God. Faith in what he said. And like Brother Travis says, applying that faith to your circumstances. What you hear, apply. Put it on.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only way to get right and get favorable standing with the Almighty God. So that's what Paul pointed back to. Then he says, knowing that, that Abraham was right with God because of his faith. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. Those was fighting words right there. because faith goes outside of the Jewish nation, the Jewish race, the Hebrew people. Anybody can have faith.
What?
Really? Yeah. Ruth.
Yes.
Ruth the whore. Ruth the business. Is that who I'm talking about?
I think you got two people mixed up.
Oh,
Ruth
was,
she wasn't a harlot.
You're thinking about
Rahab the harlot. And Ruth was not Jewish. She wasn't Jewish.
She was
Moabite.
Yeah. Rahab the harlot. Business lady. Red light district. There she is. She got in faith.
In the hall of faith. Hall of fame, even.
She got in faith. So faith can be outside of the Jewish race, is what Paul is pointing out to them. Now, this is a fighting word. You mean those Gentiles? And Gentiles back then was like the N-word, like it is today. You mean them? can have access to our God? Yeah, through faith. Ooh, faith in their hearing what they hear. So, the other children of Abraham. Now, God, if you ever read your Bible and you read your Bible, you'll see that the gospel has been preached through Scripture. Mm-hmm. The gospel, as we know it today, the Easter story, as we know it today, has been preached through Scripture.
Yes.
Even the redemptive realities has been preached through Old Testament Scriptures. And this is how you can really measure yourself if you are a true messenger of Christ, is that you can say, okay, I know the New Testament pretty well, but I can stop at Malachi and work my way back through Genesis, and I can preach to you Jesus Christ on some of those scriptures. And never come across John 3:16 and show and convict you just as much from those Old Testament books of John 3:16. I can show you Isaiah 53, by his stripes,
yes,
you are healed. Mm-hmm. I can show you in Isaiah 9 that a virgin shall conceive. It's preached in the Scripture, these things.
Or he was bruised for your iniquity.
and your sin is forgiven, and all these kind of things in Old Testament Scripture alone. So I could preach the gospel just from the Old Testament. But I come over here to the New Testament side because that's where the good stuff is. I've got some more stuff in here that you didn't know about. Everybody's in on it. Anybody.
Because I like grace.
Grace. Now, the deal is that you have to, grace is invisible. And you don't see it until it manifests. But grace is working for all the time. A person is listening and hearing to the gospel in faith, grace starts working. But we don't see it. There's Travis up here in my illustration, a pack of coons. Visually, I can't see grace. I can't see grace from my eye. But grace is working because he's hearing. Mm-hmm. That's what we ought to understand. Where sin is abounding,
grace doth much more abound.
Grace is working hard. Mm-hmm. Glory to God. So if I see a drunk stumbling down the street and there was a sign, John 3:16, guess who's working hard? But we can't see. I can't see grace. So yeah, he's working hard on that person.
Yeah, many of us, even if you'd come to our houses right after we received Christ, you couldn't see grace.
You wouldn't see grace working out there. I stepped out all right here that Tuesday, Wednesday night, went back home. I was saved in my heart and all that. But if you looked around my house, you'd think, man, this guy got it going on with all the other stuff. Whoa. Horoscope on his wall, ashtrays all around. Horoscope hanging off his car. Phone ringing all the time. Crowd at the house all the time. When did grace start working? As soon as I heard the good news, grace started working. But for the natural life, the cops came by, they said, ain't no way, you're going straight to jail.
I have been set free.
Okay, praise God. Okay, all right. And that's right. The scripture for sin, that God would justify the heathen through what? Faith. Preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, God preached to Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So the scripture and God's word was preaching to Abraham, and Abraham had to take a choice as to, do I believe it or do I don't believe it? So then, they which be of faith, are blessed with who? Faithful Abraham. And now, for some reason, Deuteronomy 21:23 is popping up. If anybody can get there real quick, Deuteronomy 21:23.
21:23?
Yeah. They which be of faith are blessed with faith. Abraham. Yeah, what's that say?
His body shall